Hello, everyone, and welcome to GIA Knowledge Sessions, a series of talks and seminars about gemology that are fueled by the decades of research that GIA has been conducting. At GIA, we're extremely lucky to study and learn from gems, and it's our mission to share our discoveries and learnings with you. Today, I'm very excited to kick things off. My name is Ulrika Danes Johansson, and I'm the manager of Diamond Research, and I am joined by Dr. Sally Magaña, a senior manager of Diamond Identification. And she's going to be telling us all about D to Z color diamonds, so the bread and butter and the fuel of the diamond trade. Now, before we get started, I have a few little housekeeping points. Everyone who's attending this seminar is automatically muted. If you have any questions, please submit it using the question and answer feature that you'll see at the bottom of your screen. Feel free to ask any questions you have as we go. There will also be a question and answer session at the end where Dr. Magaña will have the opportunity to answer a selection of your questions. We'll also be sending a recording of the session to you later today, and that message will also have a survey, and we would love to hear your feedback. And with that, I'm going to pass off to Sally.
Today, I'll be discussing one of my favorite topics, natural diamonds in the D to Z color range. With this talk, we'll be going beyond the sparkle and delving into the science. When I'm discussing colorless diamonds and what truly distinguishes them as such an amazing gem, my mind immediately just goes to the wide array of extraordinary physical properties the diamond possesses. So diamond truly is one of the most extraordinary materials on the planet. For example, it has the highest hardness. It's 10 on the Mohs scale. I'm sure most people are familiar with that. It also has the highest thermal conductivity at room temperature. That's how it gets its nickname, as ice. It has the highest molar density of any terrestrial material. I remember when my PhD advisor said that to me a number of years ago, that we had to travel to a neutron star to find a material with more atoms within a given volume. And I remember when I first heard that, just how exciting and interesting it made diamond to be. It has the lowest compressibility, which makes it resistant to being distorted by pressure. And it has the highest sound propagation velocity. Now, I'm not sure that anyone is going to buy a diamond because it has the highest sound propagation velocity, but it just goes to show that for many advantageous characteristics within a gem or within any material, diamond ranks at the top or near the top. It also has extreme resistance to acids, corrosion, and radiation, so that makes it able to withstand a lifetime or many generations of wear. It also has an extremely low thermal expansion coefficient. And that's good for us as scientists because that means that we can submerge the diamonds in liquid nitrogen, cool it down to minus 196 degrees Celsius. And at those temperatures, we're able to see a lot more of the diamond's history and story that we couldn't at room temperature. And that's just something that's not available to most other gems. So natural diamonds come in a variety of colors, shapes, and sizes. In this selection, we can see examples of the octahedron, the classic diamond shape, along with some examples of irregular and resorbed diamonds. We see various colors, from those that are colorless to those that have a slight, tiny hint of color, to some that have more pronounced, obvious yellow to brownish hues. As a scientist, we can see that each one has its own story and history. And based on the decisions of cutters and polishers, we can see these all transition into the wide variety of faceted diamonds we see in jewelry. Several articles in recent years by some of my GIA colleagues have really expanded our understanding of diamond formation. The vast majority of the world's diamonds contain nitrogen and form in some of the oldest portions of the lithosphere, this keel line that extends deeper into the earth than much of the other parts of the continents. As you go deeper in the earth, the pressure increases, and those sections of the continent are so deep that they are no longer in the graphite stability zone, but have extended into the diamond stability zone. Deeper still are the sublithospheric diamonds that originate from the upper mantle and into the lower mantle. Based on inclusion analysis, those tiny inclusions that hitchhike their way inside a diamond up to the Earth's surface, we've learned that many of these diamonds, particularly those without nitrogen, are formed at these depths. The D to Z color scale progresses from D, those with least color, and proceeds horizontally across the scale to YZ, those with the most. Beyond Z, the diamonds are considered as a fancy color diamond. The color grade is assessed based on the overall depth of color. The combined effect of tone, the lightness or darkness, along with saturation, the strength or weakness of a color. Vertically, we show the various possible hues, the most common of which is yellow. Diamonds with brown coloration also include a letter grade and, for greater than K, also a color description. For other colors, such as blue, green, or pink, these transition to the fancy color diamond scale at greater than F. For example, many type 2B diamonds, those that contain boron, are blue in color and are fancy colored. Most of the type 2B diamonds on the DDZ scale that we will be discussing today are those with low boron concentration and D to F color grades. For diamonds on the DDZ scale, there are two major causes of color. For those with yellow coloration, it derives predominantly from nitrogen-related defects, those that we call cape features. And for those with brown coloration, that color is predominantly caused by plastic deformation. We'll be discussing both of these in depth on the coming slides. We're going to start off by looking at some of the causes of color at an atomic scale. I'm showing here an illustration of pure diamond. It's solely carbon atoms perfectly arranged in its diamond cubic structure. In our pure diamond lattice, we can swap out some of the carbon atoms with other elements. For example, in this, I've swapped out some of those carbon with boron. And if the boron is present in high enough concentrations, then it can impart a blue color to the diamond. Diamonds with detectable boron within the infrared absorption, we classify as type 2B, even if we're not able to see that blue color manifest within the diamond. Alternatively, we can swap out some of those carbon atoms with nitrogen or an empty site, which we call a vacancy. You may remember from my talk last July, where I discussed the science of color in diamond, that we included several more color centers that are important for color diamonds. Today, for the D to Z diamonds, we're only going to focus on those centers most important within this color range. Now, most natural diamonds do contain nitrogen. It's one of the most abundant elements in the Earth, and the size of the nitrogen atom is comparable to the carbon atom. So it goes easily into the diamond lattice. This creates a high concentration of nitrogen within most natural diamonds. The various configurations and pairings of nitrogen can greatly influence what we can detect and know about natural diamond. When the diamonds were formed millions to billions of years ago, the nitrogen atoms within the diamond lattice were largely isolated and not adjacent to other nitrogen atoms. Over time, over the millions of years residing in the Earth, these nitrogen atoms migrate and find each other. Two of the configurations we see in natural diamond are called the A and B centers. The A center is two nitrogens paired together, and the B center is four nitrogens surrounding a vacancy. These centers absorb in the infrared and not within the visible. Therefore, you can have a diamond with lots of nitrogen, lots of defects, and it still be colorless. Complicating what I just said about time creating nitrogen pairs, which can result in a colorless diamond, is that in addition to these two centers, the A and B aggregates, there's also the creation of the N3 center, which does absorb in the visible, and if present, can impart a yellowish color. If we look instead at intrinsic defects, these are defects that involve just carbon, no other elements such as nitrogen or boron, then we can see the formation of different colored centers. For example, we can stress the diamond and add a little kink to it instead. In nature, when major geologic forces act on the diamond, this creates plastic deformation, which causes families of vacancies to form along slip planes. This will often impart a brown color to the diamond. This brownish color wasn't seen a lot before the 1980s. And when the Argyle mine opened up, brownish diamonds were seen in higher numbers. Here we're showing examples of diamonds across the color scale. Now, diamonds are graded table down, but viewed table up. So we're showing both perspectives, as well as showing examples of both diamonds with yellowish and brownish colorations. In this slide, we're showing visible near IR absorption spectra for the extreme ends of the D2Z color scale. We're also showing example spectra for type 1A diamonds with cape features, which includes most notably the N3 and N2 defects at 415 and 478 nanometers, and type 2A diamonds, those without any nitrogen or boron in their infrared spectra. In the light brown type 2A diamond, we see this gradually increasing absorption towards the lower wavelengths that is just called the brown absorption continuum and causes that brownish color. I'm going to take a brief segue to discuss the naming that is used for defect centers and to help clear up any misconceptions, because it can be rather confusing. For example, the names of color centers in diamond are a mix of historical designations and atomic configurations. For example, the N in N3, the center that we talked about earlier, that along with N2 and et cetera, that N stands for natural. The N3 happens to contain nitrogen, but that N stands for natural, not nitrogen. It is just coincidence that the N3 has three nitrogens and a vacancy. Similarly, the H in H3, along with H1, H2, H4, et cetera, that stands for heated, not hydrogen. And its composition is nitrogen, vacancy, nitrogen. Meanwhile, the N in NV, that does stand for nitrogen, and GR1, that's a center we talk a lot about in relation to green diamonds, stands for general radiation 1. So how did all of this come about? Well, it started decades ago when many centers were seen in the absorption spectra of natural and heated diamonds. And researchers designated the peaks by counting across the spectra as 1, 2, 3, et cetera. So these defects are now identified. And some, like the N3, are more important than some of the others. And so we hear about those more. And additionally, some of the so-called heated centers, such as H3, are also detected in natural unheated diamonds. So I hope that clears up about the naming on some of these defect centers. And even if it is confusing, this defect nomenclature does remain. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about the N3 defect. As we mentioned it before, it's composed of three nitrogens and a vacancy. It has its principal absorption and emission at 415 nanometers. It can create both yellow color, but also blue fluorescence. And so invariably, if you see blue fluorescence in a colorless diamond under long wave UV in a natural diamond, then it's most likely due to the 415 nanometer N3 defect. In diamonds that are brownish, that color is created by something called plastic deformation. With that in mind, I'd like to talk a little bit about plastic deformation and the geologic forces that could be creating it. Over on the left is an illustration of the types of scenarios that typically cause deformation. But just keep in mind that the specific scenario at some locality may be different, or plastic deformation could be caused during the ascent of the diamond. At the temperatures experienced while in the earth, the diamond will respond to those geologic stresses by undergoing plastic deformation and getting that little kink that we showed earlier in the diamond structure. Over on the far right, I'm showing a fun example illustrating that at room temperature, a material can have very different reactions than at higher temperature. Plastic deformation is also seen in natural peak diamonds. And this rough crystal shows a great example of what happens when a diamond is stressed. We can see in the fluorescence image how the growth features have shifted, and in your mind's eye, you can slide those individual slices and imagine how the fluorescence of the diamond looked prior to that deformation and can reformulate the original growth structure before it was deformed by these stresses. This is a great example of plastic deformation. Great stone. I love this one. We spoke earlier about nitrogen-related defects, and I wanted to discuss a little bit more about the progression that occurs for nitrogen in these diamonds while they are in the earth. Most natural diamonds, about 98%, do contain nitrogen and will follow this pathway. They start off after they're formed as type 1b, meaning they have single isolated nitrogen. And with time and temperature, these natural diamonds, the nitrogen within these natural diamonds will migrate and find each other and pair up to form the A centers. And as they continue to reside within the earth, some of these centers will continue to find more nitrogen atoms until they ultimately form what's called the B aggregate, four nitrogens surrounding a vacancy. And so these are the two major things that we, centers that we see within diamond, and most natural diamonds have a mixture of A and B aggregates. Additionally, as we go along this aggregation pathway, we also see the formation of the N3 defect that creates the visible absorption and emission at 415 nanometers. So over here on the right, I'm showing some examples of some infrared absorption spectra, the nitrogen region within these spectra. And we're starting off with a pure type 1AA diamond. And with increased time and temperature, we see this gradual transition from all A aggregates to the introduction of B aggregates until when we completed this aggregation pathway, we have 100% B aggregates and we have a type 1AB diamond. Now, a very small percentage of natural diamonds will be classified as type 1B. With nitrogen preserved in its original form. And very few natural diamonds are type 1AB, and that has gone completely down the aggregation pathway. Most diamonds, about 98 to 98%, are somewhere on this A to B pathway and have a mixture of A to B aggregates. For much of the rest of my talk, I will be discussing and showing the results of a statistical study we performed on natural D2Z diamonds. In this study, we looked at all D2Z diamonds submitted to GIA, all labs, all services, and all concluded natural during 2017. Just as an illustration, one of my fellow researchers, Troy Arden, he wrote software especially to analyze the data for the study. It took four of his computers 1 month to process the spectral data for these diamonds. One of the reasons our data set needed to be so large was so that we could have adequate representation and distribution of diamonds among these rare diamond types that had very low percentages overall. Also, please keep in mind that we are providing a snapshot of all diamonds that were submitted to GIA, and that this snapshot may not be representative of all diamonds available on the market or representative of what we might see today or in the coming years. For example, once we start to see the impact of the Argyle mine closing, we might start to see a change in the sort of statistics that I'm showing today. One of the first things we did for all the diamonds in this data set was to determine diamond type. And I show that here in this table. The vast majority of the stones, as expected, were type 1A, where the infrared absorption spectra were saturated and we could not determine the A or B aggregates, or is type 1AAB, and it had that mixture. But 99.06% were those. Very small percentage were type 1AB, that they had completed that aggregation pathway, and that percentage was 0.09%. Another small percentage were type 2A, that had no detectable nitrogen or boron within the infrared absorption spectra. And that percentage is 0.83%. And then a very small percentage for type 2B, 0.02%. Also keep in mind that there are many type 2B samples that would be considered fancy color diamonds and not positioned on the D to Z color scale. Over on the right, I show an example of why diamond type is so important for us. For natural diamonds, we show that 99% of those are type 1A, and we have about 0.1% as type 1AB and 0.9% as type 2. So a very small percentage compared to the vast population of natural type 1As. Among HPHT treated diamonds, the vast majority of those are type 2. In our survey, we found that 99.5% of the HPHT treated diamonds were type 2 and 0.5% were type 1AB. Now, among lab-grown diamonds, whether they're HPHT-grown or CVD-grown, 100% of those were type 2. So that just shows you an example of why diamond type is so important for screening between natural, treated, and lab-grown diamonds. I'm going to look at the various diamond types in detail. I'm going to start off by talking about the type 1A, type 1A AB diamonds. Like I mentioned earlier, these comprise the majority of natural gem diamonds, about 99%. Many of these diamonds contain high quantities of nitrogen and in configurations that cannot be duplicated among lab-grown diamonds. And over here on the right, I show the Moad Dynasty diamond. It was 179 carats in the rough and faceted to 51.12 carats with a D flawless color grade. This plot shows the distribution of color grades among the entire population of type 1AB diamonds in the study. You can see that the maximum is at the F to G color grades. We see a sharp decline in the alphabet as we go. We see a sharp decline as we go higher in the alphabet, with a very small percentage seen at those higher color grades. On here, we show some of the results for the infrared absorption spectra. And what we saw from looking at these is that the vast majority of the diamonds that are type 1A actually have such high amounts of nitrogen that the infrared absorption spectra was saturated, the nitrogen region is saturated. And I show an example here. So that means for these diamonds, we could not determine what the nitrogen concentration was or the ratio of A to B aggregates. All we can say is that just the nitrogen was very high within these samples. So on this, for colorless diamonds, we can see that these have a much lower percentage of diamonds with saturated nitrogen within the IR, and thus generally less nitrogen. High in the alphabet, we can see a slight decrease in the percentage showing saturated spectra. And this is likely related to the increase in number of diamonds that have brown color within these color grades. This plot shows the percentages of diamonds that were classified as brown or yellow. And we've always known that yellow coloration was more common than brown, but with this plot, we can start to get an idea of how much more prevalent it is. Now, keep in mind that there is a continuum from yellow to brown, such as diamonds showing a yellowish brown or brownish yellow coloration. So the reality is not a binary choice like what is shown here, but we illustrate brown and yellow as these are generally the two pathways for D to Z colors. So for near colorless diamonds, those that are G to J, we see a high percentage, about 95%, which would be classified within the yellowish hue range. As we go higher in the alphabet towards O to Z, we can see this gradual progression and that a higher percentage of diamonds within each color grade are brownish. This plot shows the weight distribution for type 1A diamonds. And as we can see, the majority are 1 carat or less. We can also see spikes at the weight thresholds, such as what we see at 1 carat, 1.5 carat, 2 carat, et cetera. This slide shows the clarity grade distribution from flawless to I3. We can see the maximum is around VS1 to SI1. And it shows what we would call, what scientists or mathematicians would call a normal distribution. At the right, we show what are the grade setting inclusions. And we can see that the most abundant ones include crystals, feathers, clouds, and twinning wisp. This plot on the left shows the fluorescence intensity that was seen in these type 1A diamonds. And for this data set, we had around 80% of the type 1A diamonds that showed no fluorescence. And then quite a bit of another, and then afterwards we see faint and then falling off from there. Over on the right, we show what the observed fluorescence color was, if fluorescence was seen. And so in the vast majority of the diamonds, about 97.5% that had fluorescence, it showed blue color. And I'm sure that the vast majority of those had blue fluorescence due to the N3 defect. And then we show some of the population of some of the other fluorescence colors that could possibly be seen, such as yellow or green, which would be due to the H3 defect. Among the diamonds that did not show saturated nitrogen, we were able to determine the concentration of A and B aggregates and work out some trends by comparing those values of A and B aggregate concentrations with the observed fluorescence. So scientists have learned previously that A aggregates quench, that is, suppress blue fluorescence. So it's not surprising that diamonds with no fluorescence show a higher concentration of A aggregates. On this plot, I'm showing the concentration of A and B aggregates versus fluorescence intensity. And one thing I'm also showing is that the heavy line for each of the plots is the median value. And then above and below are the upper and lower quartiles for both the A aggregates and the B aggregates. As we see an increase in the fluorescence intensity from none to very strong, we also see an increase in this B aggregate concentration. That makes sense when you think about that aggregation pathway. And as A aggregates transition to B aggregates, then it makes sense that additional N3 could possibly be formed as well, thus increasing the overall fluorescence intensity. For strong and very strong fluorescence, we also see a decrease in A aggregates, showing that they're less able to quench the observed fluorescence. And then over on the right, I show the well-known Portuguese diamond that's on display at the Smithsonian. And due to the combination of its 127 carat size and its strong fluorescence, it's able to emit enough fluorescence that you can read by it. So that's definitely a very interesting example showing fluorescence in diamond. So I'm gonna move now to discuss type 1AB diamonds. These comprise much less than 1% of natural diamonds, and in this study, it was about 0.1%. So many type 1AB diamonds, they originate deep in the Earth's mantle, and the high temperature that is present within the deep mantle helps to facilitate that nitrogen aggregation and helps push it to completion along that aggregation pathway. And then on the right, I show an image for the constellation, a type 1AB diamond from the Karowe mine in Botswana. This slide shows the color grade distribution for type 1AB diamonds. And one thing that was interesting to me as part of doing this study was that the most abundant among the type 1AB diamonds were the D color, that a majority of the type 1ABs had D color, and then it drops off as you go to the higher color grades. And then over on the right, I show the average nitrogen concentration for these type 1AB diamonds versus the color grade. So at the left, we see that it has low amounts of nitrogen. And then we start to see an increase towards the F to G colors. And then we start to see a gradual decrease as we go to higher color grades, in which a brownish color contribution due to plastic deformation is starting to have a larger effect. These plots show on the left, we show the distribution of clarity grade for type 1AB diamonds with a maximum at SI1. And like with the type 1A diamonds, we also see a normal distribution where we have for the clarity grades. And then over on the right, we show what the grade setting inclusions are within these diamonds. They include crystals, feathers, clouds, twinning wisp, and then several others as well. I'm going to talk a little bit here about this continuum that we can see in type 1AB diamonds. Now, the vast majority of type 1AB diamonds are that are colorless and near colorless are on the D to Z scale. However, we can also see examples of D to Z diamonds that have these milky or hazy observations. These are typically type 1AB diamonds with whitish graining and or clouds. And then if you move further along that continuum, then you approach fancy whites. Fancy whites are a fancy color diamond, but the vast majority of them are type 1AB. And so I just wanna talk a little bit about what fancy white diamonds are, because they have this close kinship with D to Z type 1AB diamonds. Now, we discussed fancy whites in a previous article in the fall 2019 issue of Gems and Gemology. And one things that we discussed were the origins of the cloudy or hazy observations that are seen in the fancy white diamonds, but also in those that are on the D to Z scale that are classified with some sort of hazy or milky observation. And what previous researchers found was that the inclusions predominantly seen in fancy white diamonds are either nanometer sized inclusions, and there's no consensus on the makeup of these inclusions, but they likely include nitrogen, or TEM also showed that it was through the formation of dislocation loops. Now, dislocation loops are disruptions in the crystal lattice that form into this donut shape of distorted atoms, since the loop itself exists at a lower energy than the isolated lattice defects. And so this donut shape that I show in red can exist within the normal crystal structure, which I show here in blue. I thought it would also be interesting to compare the fluorescence results between the D to Z diamonds that are type 1AB and the fancy white diamonds that were type 1AB. Now, only about half of the D to Z type 1AB diamonds showed no fluorescence, while the fancy white diamonds showed a much higher percentage with faint or medium fluorescence, but it had lower percentages of strong, a very strong fluorescence compared to their D to Z cousins. I'm going to shift now to discuss type 2B diamonds. And these comprise much less than 1% of natural gem diamonds for this study, about 0.02%. And over on the right, I do show a 5-carat example of a D-colored diamond that had about 5 parts per billion of boron. It wasn't easy to find a type 2B diamond that was in the for showing that was in the D to Z color range. Most of those are in the fancy color range. And that's because most type 2B diamonds do have that blue coloration and are not positioned on the D to Z scale. One of my GIA colleagues, Dr. Evan Smith, performed some research and determined that type 2B diamonds likely originate deep within the Earth's mantle. And these were first sourced from India, particularly the Golconda region, but they're now found throughout the world, but most notably from the Cullinan mine in South Africa. This plot has a lot on it, so I'm going to take a bit to go through each of the different components. It shows several infrared absorption spectra. And from these, we can see that diamonds do not have detectable nitrogen. But we can see the presence of boron by this peak at 2800 wave numbers. The area under this peak can be used to directly calculate the concentration of uncompensated boron that is affecting the color. Now, the interesting thing about this feature is that it directly creates the absorption that causes the blue color. As the peak at 2800 wave numbers increases, it increases the slope of that absorption, and that extends from the mid-IR to the near-IR and ultimately into the red. This gradient creates that transmission window within the blue part of the visible. So if that boron peak is small, like in the bottom spectrum, then the resulting slope is not very high, and so we see a colorless diamond. One other interesting thing to note is that we are measuring within the infrared is not the total boron concentration, but it's the uncompensated boron. That is the surplus of boron that is not compensated electrically by other competing defects within the diamond. So we can see type 2B diamonds are found in locations throughout the world, but most notably they're found today from the Cullinan mine in South Africa. Dr. Evan Smith, he studied inclusions in the type 2B diamonds and found that these formed within the lower mantle and are classified as super deep. This plot shows on the left, it shows the distribution for the color grade among type 2B diamonds. And as you can see, the vast majority of those of the type 2B diamonds are D color. And then it falls off quite precipitously from there as we go higher in the alphabet. So most of the diamonds, as you'd expect, are D, E, and F, because if they, as most type 2B diamonds, when they have more color, they will transition to the fancy color scale. Probably the most of the remaining ones that are type 2B, but have a color grade of G or higher in the alphabet, probably have some gray coloration, or sometimes brown coloration can occur as well in type 2B diamonds. And then over on the right, I show the boron concentration that was calculated for a large number of type 2B diamonds. And we can see that the very lowest concentrations are those that have color grades of D to F. And as we go higher in saturation, we transition from the D to Z color scale to the fancy color scale, and we start to get color grades such as intense, fancy vivid, or fancy deep. Then we see this general increase in the amount of boron concentration within these diamonds. This plot shows the distribution for carat weight among the type 2B diamonds. And as you can see, the majority of when I show these carat weight plots, they're split up into 10th carat increments. So anything between say 0.9 and 1 carat would all be grouped within the same bin on this plot. But most of the diamonds that we see have carat weights of 1 carat or less. I'm going to turn now to type 2A diamonds. These are stones that have no nitrogen or boron detectable within the infrared absorption spectra. And these comprise less than 2% of natural gem diamonds. And in this study, we had it as about 0.8%. Now, many type 2 diamonds, although not all, originate deep within the Earth's mantle. And then over on the right, I show the Cullinan, one of the most famous type 2A diamonds. This is from the Premier mine, and now the Cullinan mine in South Africa. This plot shows on the left the color grade distribution that we saw for type 2A diamonds. And like with the type 1AB and the type 2B, we see that the majority of these are D-colored diamonds, and we see that decrease from there. And I must say that when I first started doing this, it was interesting to me when I went through the study to realize just how many type 2 diamonds are D-color. I mean, I look at type 2A diamonds all the time as part of the identification process. And of course, many of those are D color, but I hadn't realized until we ran the statistics that they compose such a high majority of this diamond type. So that was definitely an interesting finding for me to learn as we went through this study. Now on the left, I show the carat weight distribution for type 2A diamonds. And as with the other stones, we are starting to, we do see the majority of them are less than 1 carat, but we can also see this, some spikes at those weight thresholds. We can also see that about slightly greater than 5% of the type 2A diamonds have a carat weight of greater than 5. And then over on the right, I show the fluorescence intensity observations that we saw for type 2A diamonds. And you can see that the vast majority of them, all about 98% of these, have no fluorescence. And that makes sense because if there's no detectable nitrogen within the infrared, then there's not going to be the availability of much N3 centers that would create a fluorescence observation. Type 2 diamonds, I'm grouping both type 2A and type 2B because they have such a similar pattern in their clarity grade, and I wanted to spend some time discussing this unusual pattern. So type 2 diamonds, they have this bimodal clarity grade distribution. That is, they show a maximum in percentage of diamonds with IF or VVS1 clarity grades, and then another maximum at around VS2. And that's indicated by the arrows on the graph. This pattern is seen independently in both the type 2A and the type 2B diamonds. And as you may remember, the type 1 diamonds, both the type 1A and the type 1AB, showed a normal distribution with one maximum at about VS2 SI1 clarity grades. We wanted to look further at these two distinct populations. And the results showed that among type 2A, and type 2B diamonds with VVS1 clarity, feathers were the most common grade setting inclusions, while others such as pinpoints or clouds generally were not seen. At lower clarity grades in the type 2A diamonds, crystals or feathers were the most common. But of course, a VVS1 feather and a VS2 feather would be quite different in appearance. Another interesting observation was that if we limited ourselves to just those type 2A diamonds that were greater than 10 carats, we see the majority of those large type 2 diamonds are flawless to VVS1, and we don't see the second maximum at around the VS2 clarity grade. And then over on the right, we show the distribution for the grade setting inclusions in both type 2A and type 2B diamonds, most of them having crystals, feathers, or something else. And actually a very small percentage showed twinning wisp as inclusions within the diamonds. Now, there are many other aspects of colorless to near colorless diamonds, and I will only briefly touch on these. Other GIA colleagues that are here would be far more qualified to speak about these issues at length. But the planning of the faceted diamond is a combination of many factors, such as inclusion location, where the location of an inclusion within a diamond, the size and shape of the rough, and the color as well. So one may make certain decisions about cutting if the rough is colorless that they would not make if it was light yellow. And then on the slide on the left, I'm showing planning that might be done for a couple of different shapes. So on the left, we have the octahedron diamond shape for the rough. And for that, the planners would most likely choose, say, 2 round brilliance to make from that. And then on the right, we show a more irregularly shaped rough that might lend itself to some more of the fancy shapes. This slide shows the shape distribution for all of the natural DDZ diamonds that were submitted in 2017. And you can see that the vast majority of those were round in shape. This plot shows the cut grades over about a 15-year period. And we can see that the cut grade has improved significantly over the last 15 years. Particularly those that those with an excellent cut grade. And so now we're seeing a majority of diamonds that have an excellent cut grade as a result. And I just want to mention that there is so much beauty to be found in colorless diamonds, whether they're type 2A, type 1A, and they can be used wonderfully in some captivating pieces of jewelry, whether in concert with other gem materials or as the star. But before we go, I did want to mention a little bit about HPHT treated diamonds. And just mention a few of the statistics that we've seen for this class of diamonds. We've talked quite a bit before about lab-grown diamonds and natural diamonds, and some about color treatments, but I did want to spend a few minutes about the HPHT treatment that decolorizes a natural diamond. And as I mentioned earlier, this can only be performed on type 2A, type 2B, or type 1AB diamonds. It cannot be performed on the type 1A or 1AAB diamonds, which are the vast majority of natural DDZ diamonds. This HPHT treatment began about 20 years ago and is used, and it uses the same presses that can be used to create the HPHT lab-grown diamonds, although the conditions for within the presses are quite different. And then just for the statistical distributions shown on the next slide, we looked at all HPHT treated diamonds from the year 2007 to 2017. For the natural diamonds, we just focused on 2017, but for the HPHT diamonds, since that data set was not as large, we covered a 10-year period. So this shows the color distribution for HPHT treated D2Z diamonds. And most of those were treated to the colorless range, D, E, or F, with the maximum being at the E color. The plot on the left shows the weight distribution. And we can see that among HPHT treated diamonds, there are a fair number a quantity of these that have carat weights higher than 1 carat. And in fact, about 11% of these HPHT treated diamonds have a carat weight of greater than 5 carats. And then over on the right, I showed the shape distribution for HPHT treated diamonds, with about 70% of those having a round shape. And then the balance having the various fancy shapes. On the left, I'm showing the clarity grade distribution for HPHT treated diamonds. And you can see that most of them are skewed towards the higher clarity grades. And that makes sense if you think about that the vast majority of these are type 2A. And we saw earlier about the natural type 2As that many of those were skewed towards the higher clarity grades, but also the treaters have to choose high clarity material in order to be put into the presses. And then over on the right, we show what are the major clarity grades seen within HPHT treated D2Z diamonds, and the majority of them are feathers. In conclusion, I just want to briefly recount this landmark series that we've put together over the last few years, and that culminated with this final webinar in which we described the diamonds on the D2Z color scale. I want to recognize my co-authors who are part of the series, Dr. Christopher Mike Breeding, Dr. Jan Shigley, Troy Arden, and Dr. Karen Smith, who helped co-author those articles in Gems and Gemology. Also, I want to, the series talks that went along with several of these articles were co-presented with Dr. Mike Breeding. So thank you very much for your time and attention, and we'll be happy to take your questions.
Thank you very much, Sally, for that wonderful presentation. There's so much information and statistics that you provided all the listeners. So thank you for that. So now we're just gonna go through some questions that we received from the audience. Mm-hmm. Let's see here. So one of the questions I received is, if you have a diamond that has exactly the same properties, so you know, the same color, the same fluorescence, et cetera, is there a differential between in the prices of the different diamond types? So is one of the diamond types considered to be more desirable in the trade?
I can provide the diamond type, and then the people who are evaluating that diamond or appraising the diamond, they can decide what the corresponding value is with the diamond type. But as a scientist, I don't assign value. So that would probably best be determined by an appraiser or a dealer, but I can certainly provide the diamond type to that individual.
Of course. I think that, yeah, as you say, one of the key things that GIA does do is the diamond type letter. So within the trade, there are certain members of the trade that prefer certain diamond types. And for that, GIA does have a diamond type letter that can be produced for any diamond, whether it's D to Z or fancy colored.
Right.
Thank you. Another question that I received was actually about laboratory grown diamonds. So in your presentation, you showed that for D to Z diamonds, the vast majority of natural diamonds were type one and the laboratory grown diamonds were type two. Is it possible to grow a type one diamond that falls within this color range?
For that specific slide, it may not have been able to see the header, but I limited that to D to N. Mm-hmm. That diamond type distribution did not cover the full D to Z color range. And I did that deliberately because there are some things that can happen up higher in the alphabet that don't apply at the lower color grades. So the vast majority of stones are in the colorless to near colorless or even can extend to N. Most of the screening devices, such as among the GIA devices, like the Diamond Check, that's provides for D to N color grades, and the ID100 is, I believe, the D to J. So when we're looking to distinguish the screening, it applies mostly for the D to J or D to N diamonds.
Yes, exactly. As you say, D to N color, laboratory grown diamonds will all be exclusively type two.
Yes.
Rather than type one.
Yes.
And then we've got time for another question. So there was a question about plastic deformation. Would you just mind explaining a little bit more about the concept of plastic deformation and what it might be?
Okay. We haven't been able to reproduce it in the laboratory. For example, the pink diamonds that get their color from plastic deformation, they have a broad band at 550 nanometers, and we've not been able to reproduce that 550 nanometer band within the laboratory. So we don't fully know everything associated with it. Certainly CVD diamonds can grow as brown color, but that's a little slightly different than the brown color we see in natural diamonds by plastic deformation. And so what we can best surmise is just that as the diamonds are stressed deep within the earth and they are subjected to geologic forces such as mountain building events or during the process of their ascent up to the surface, it undergoes that plastic deformation, and that creates these families of vacancies that are called vacancy clusters and help bring about that brown color.
Great, thank you very much. That's a very clear answer to the question. Are you able to tell a diamond type just by looking at it, or do you need to use some form of instrumentation for this?
I would say you would need to use instrumentation. You can have some clues, such as fluorescence. We certainly saw a distinct difference in the presence of fluorescence in type two diamonds, in which almost 100% of those showed no fluorescence. And if something shows phosphorescence, the blue phosphorescence, and you might be able to surmise that it's a type 2B. There's some inclusions that were far more common in type 1 diamonds compared to the type 2 diamonds, but those are just possible indications. It's not ever, I would never take it as proof. I would always rely on some sort of spectral measurement to confirm it.
Wonderful. Well, thank you very much, Sally, for all the information that you've provided and for your answers to these questions. I think we're going to wrap up now. If any of you audience members have any lingering questions, please send them to us via Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Twitter. So through any of our social media channels. Thank you very much for joining us today. And please join us again on May 13th, where we'll be joined by, once again, Sally, but also Nicole Aline, Stuart, and Stuart Overlin. We'll be discussing the latest discoveries in gems and gemology. So this is on Thursday, May 13th. And thank you once again, Sally, for your excellent presentation. Goodbye, everyone.